Thank you. Lee C. Bollinger for the degree of Doctor of Laws, honoris causa. Lifelong advocate of a more tolerant society, you return to Columbia as president to lead us as we set the course for this new century. Columbia is proud to welcome you home for what we hope will be a long and successful run as our 19th president with a degree of Doctor of Laws, honoris causa.
Today is your day, and after all the hard work you have put into your education over so many years of your lives, you deserve every ounce of satisfaction and pride we hope you are now feeling in what you have achieved.
And friends, university guests and degree candidates from the class of 2023. Welcome to the Columbia University Commencement of the 269th academic year. By tradition, the University Commencement begins with a procession of the academic divisions. Friends and family, serving as honorary head marshal, Dr. Richard Axel, with head marshals Katie Conway and Cindy Kong. Please welcome the first division of the academic procession, the alumni anniversary classes. And now, the faculty of Columbia University. Thank you. please welcome the officers of the libraries and the officers of research of the university. Administrative officers and officers emeriti of the university. Family and friends, the University Senate, leadership, and military guests. Thank you. Please welcome the presenting deans of the schools and colleges of the university. Family and friends, please welcome our candidates for the Medal of Excellence and honorary degrees, escorted by Columbia University trustees and marshaled by Michael H. Biowitz of the 50th anniversary class, with Dr. Dennis Mitchell and Alex Schender of the 25th anniversary class, with Dr. Alan Hyman. Please welcome the recipients of the Presidential Awards for Outstanding Teaching, marshaled by Bert Wong. And now, the recipients of the Faculty Mentoring Awards and Faculty Service Awards, marshaled by Vina Tran. Family and friends, please welcome the alumni medalists, marshaled by Donna McPhee and Keith Goggin. Please welcome the trustees of Barnard College and Teachers College representatives. Family and friends, the trustees and trustees emeriti of the university. And now, the final division of the academic procession, marshaled by Justin Perlman. University Chaplain Janelle Davis. Executive Vice President for Arts and Sciences and Dean of the Faculty of Arts and Sciences, today's ceremony presenter, Amy Hungerford. Provost Mary Boyce. The Columbia Mace signifies the university president's authority to confer degrees on the students of Columbia. This year, our mace bearer is Susan G. Peterson. Family and friends, Lee C. Bollinger, for his final commencement as university president.
President, seated before you are the trustees, faculty, alumni, candidates for degrees, and honored guests of Columbia University, assembled for the annual commencement in Columbia's 269th academic year. With your permission, Mr. President, the exercises will now begin. Please stand for the vocal performance of the National Anthem by Stephen Charles, General Studies Class of 2023, and the American Sign Language performance by Katie Brennan, Columbia College, class of 2023.
But so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave? O'er the land of the free,
to feature this performance now of Lift Every Voice and Sing by Janelle LeBlanc, Teachers College, Class of 2023.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring, ring with the harmony of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling seas. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on till victory is won.
The opening words will be pronounced by Janelle Davis, University Chaplain.
Thank you. Please be seated. Your Columbia University degree will identify you around the globe as among the best educated individuals in the world. You graduate into a global community that is interconnected and rapidly changing. Every day is filled with news of domestic and civil conflicts and international challenges. You will live and lead in a world where healthcare disparities, economic injustice, the unhoused, and racial fractures have come to the forefront of our social, political, and our common life. You graduate at a time when the production of information, news, freedom of speech, and AI are redefining communication strategies, imagination, and the definition of facts and truth. Graduates, challenges and opportunities are expanding for people who are brave, courageous people of good character and goodwill. As Columbia University alumni, you have the opportunities and responsibilities to help address the most critical local, national, and global issues of our times. You can and will give guidance on matters of international affairs, public policy, business, engineering, architecture, the arts, the humanities, the social and the natural sciences. You will give counsel on matters of climate change, environmental sciences, law, data science, communication technologies, finance, economics, social work, education, media, and journalism. You will be on the vanguard of public health policy, research in neuroscience, dentistry, nursing, and medicine. You will write our stories, paint our canvases, make our films, and delight our souls with dance, music, and theater. You will give voice to the common good of us all. May you enjoy the blessings of lifelong learning, the demands of reasoned optimism, and the joys of daring dreams. Stay brave. Be brave. May it be so. May it be so.
Family and friends in attendance, the president of the university, Lee C. Bollinger.
It is my very, very great honor, indeed privilege and joy, to welcome you all here on this very special morning, in this glorious academic setting, to this magnificent occasion. I am especially sentimental today, as this will be my last commencement speech after serving more than two decades as president of Columbia University. I like to think that we are graduating together. I'm sure that you and I, that was the response I hoped to elicit. I am sure that you and I both will hold this moment in our hearts for the rest of our lives. On a personal note, I'm pleased to say I have a job. I now return to the life of a law professor, a career I began at more or less your age in 1973, 2 years after graduating from our law school. I have loved being president of this great academic institution. By any measure I can think of, it has been a worthy way to spend my life. And most importantly, a transformative education in itself. This transition for me is somewhat complicated, a word you will hear me say a lot this morning. I feel some elements of sadness as I leave behind colleagues, everyone a dear friend, and adjust to a world in which I am increasingly unneeded. But certainly I am delighted to have more space and time in life for other things. Perhaps the way your families felt when you went off to school. However, endings are a part of life, as this occasion so poignantly symbolizes, and I couldn't be happier that Manoush Shafiq will become our next president. Manoush. So let me say personally and on behalf of the faculty and the staff administration how thankful we are to each and every one of you for enriching our lives. And this appreciation extends to all who have supported you throughout your academic journey. Please take a moment to thank them as well.
I thought a lot about what to say to you on this occasion. One naturally feels an expectation to offer thoughts as profound as this moment is in your lives. Given all that's happening in the world, you might well expect me to talk about big issues, and in particular, big threats to democracy. But it strikes me that you are already well-versed in civilization-scale problems that your generation has been tasked with solving. What I can do, and I hope to do, is to sum up a little part of what I have learned over time contributes to a good life. I am interested in the seemingly simple matter of how to be a person in the world and what qualities to nurture and develop. I don't have a precise name for what I'm going to talk about, but in general, it's about developing a certain disposition of openness, something frequently commented on, but little appreciated in how hard it is to achieve and sustain. Being open-minded, whether as a society or as an individual, has many models. The place we typically start in thinking about the subject is the First Amendment and the sacred principle of freedom of speech. That is something I happen to know a little about. But I am not turning to the First Amendment for the reason you might think, as some kind of article of faith that we all should strive to live by. In fact, quite the opposite in many respects. I understand why, in this current age, some of you may feel the First Amendment protects too many bad things, giving oxygen to the toxic forces that divide us. To that, I would say that's a legitimate debate and always has been and always will. Rather, I want to use the First Amendment as a point of reference as we set about the far more complex task of creating our own personal free speech, as it were. This is where we decide for ourselves how to think, learn, tolerate, or not, engage with others or not, including those with whom we are closest. I propose that we see life as having different ways or layers of trying to achieve the same thing and compare them and look at how they intersect. I see the First Amendment as a point of departure, not a destination, as it were. We are letting ourselves off the hook when we expect society to conform to standards that we know from our own lives are too unyielding to accommodate life's infinite subtleties. But we begin with free speech and the First Amendment. In the United States, we proudly have decided, primarily through Supreme Court cases over the last century, that the government or the state should not, quote, censor speech except in extreme situations. For example, when it poses a serious and imminent risk of violence. This means that we must withhold imposing sanctions on speech that is racist or anti-Semitic or materially and dangerously false. We exercise this self-restraint only towards behavior we classify as, quote, speech, a puzzle in itself, and we embed it as a fundamental principle in the Constitution. To the questions why and to what ends, we say the following. First, we recognize that human nature is not naturally open to other beliefs and ideas. We are made for intolerance, not tolerance. Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes, Jr. expressed this premise explicitly and succinctly in 1920 as he initiated the cascade of jurisprudence we live by today. He acknowledged, quote, persecution for the expression of opinions seems to me perfectly logical. If you have no doubt of your premises or your power, and you want a result with all your heart, you naturally express your wishes in law and sweep away the opposition. To allow opposition by speech seems to indicate that you think the speech impotent, or that you do not care wholeheartedly for the result, or that you doubt either your power or your premises. So intolerance or persecution towards other beliefs and opinions is perfectly logical. But that's not the end of the story, Holmes says famously. We need to reject these natural impulses and aim for something higher, namely truth. For when we realize, he says, that time has upset many fighting faiths, then we come to believe that the ultimate good desired is better reached by free trade in ideas, that the best test of truth is the power of a thought to get itself accepted in the competition of the market, and that truth is the only ground upon which their wishes safely can be carried out. This, as it were, has become the American creed. And it is a wonderful and really glorious thing. But given the problematic relationship between the premise and the ideal, it is no wonder that each new generation must work to understand and live by this faith. It's also odd, more intricate than this, because we do not live by this faith throughout all society, and certainly not in our own lives, even when we have the same goals in mind. Take where we are right this minute. In the academic world, a very different framework applies in the search for truth. Here the quest is bounded by strict norms of objectivity, reason, civility, peer review, full attribution, and constant skepticism applied to one's own ideas. In this realm, what I like to refer to as the scholarly temperament prevails. And for those who abridge those norms, the penalties, the censorship, as it were, by another name, are severe, non-promotion, and even exclusion. As with the First Amendment commitment to free speech, the scholarly temperament does not come easily. It is only achieved by education and mental discipline. Here then are two worlds I and you know well. They are very different in character, very different in the precepts about the permissible intellectual traits, yet both are dedicated to the discovery of truth. One is like a wilderness, and the other a manicured garden. I won't here go into how to square the two worlds in a society such as ours, nor whether they even need to be squared. My main point takes a different path. What I want to get to is our own lives, the ones that each of us constructs day after day. None of us would ever choose personally to live according to the dictates of the First Amendment or the scholarly temperament. They may well be appropriate for their respective spheres, and they may each, in their own way, be models for us to turn to for guidance as we create our own. But they will not work for ordinary life, even for the same goal. Here is where my recommendations come in. Let me say first, however, that I'm not trying to solve the larger questions each of us confronts about who we will be, or what beliefs we will hold, or with what degrees of intensity and conviction. We need courage to fight for justice. That is another topic. My focus today is how we build within ourselves a disposition to be open-minded that is authentic, lasting, and ultimately a force for positive change. So here are some ideas I have turned to myself for help. I have found them useful in building my own understanding and knowledge, in feeling freer and happier, and for nurturing relationships with others. There are 10, I say, under my breath. The first, and in many ways the most important recommendation, is to be constantly alert to our natural impulses that lead us astray. Here you need to start with where the First Amendment starts, and Holmes was right. We will have our beliefs, and the more strongly we hold them, the more we will want to protect them from contradiction and rejection. But our impulse is even more dangerous than Holmes suggested. Not only do we want to, quote, persecute opposition, we also want to join with others in feeling fortified and righteous in doing so. We want to agree to agree. In other words, we need to see that our natural inclination is to be closed-minded, not open-minded. We are not born believing in free speech or openness. We have to learn to be this other way. From there, I think it's helpful to develop a conscious awareness of how little we, even experts, actually know about ourselves and our world. Human knowledge is vast and stupendous, stupendous as this university attests, as a repository of human knowledge. But our ignorance is far greater. I love and have enormous respect for expertise, but you have to be careful not to let it be intimidating. And the best way to do that is to peer into our shared ignorance, for that is where we find our sense of shared humanity and where old and new things await our discovery. Next, for those things we do and can know, we must always work on seeing their complexity as deeply as we can. The mind naturally simplifies things and looks for and assumes there are answers. Sometimes there are, but more often there are choices to be made. I always tell my students to try to make the problems we study as complex as possible. And I suggest you follow the tried and true method of academics to ready their minds by beginning every response by saying, "Well, it's complicated," and then go on from there. Next, once you see the centrifugal forces against openness and you see the path ahead, you realize this is something that happens only by continuous practice, by habit. You have to make it part of who you are and do it over and over again. Just saying to people, "Be open," is like saying to someone, "Go play the piano." You have to work at it to build your capacities, gain agility and strength. And that's why pianists do scales, and these are scales for open-mindedness. Now, when you are in conversations with people, which is a great way to learn, you should always ask more questions than give answers. Everyone has something to teach us, something of unique interest, and your task is always to find that. Keep the proportions of questions to answers at least 80%. Given human nature, I predict you will have no problems succeeding in this, unless you run into someone who was at this commencement, who actually listened to what I'm saying, and who was persuaded. A vanishingly small pool of people, I realize. Then try this. When you encounter a problem, an issue, on which reasonable people disagree, imagine all the arguments you would make until the point where no alternative seems possible. Then start all over again. Imagine you are the other person and make their arguments to the same end in your mind. And then try to hold both arguments in your head at once. This is very, very hard to do. The seventh idea is always remember that the problems of life may be different in consequence, but are more or less equal in complexity. As your parents will no doubt agree, deciding which school to send your child to can be just as vexing as any matter of American foreign policy. Do not be dismissive of any opportunity to bear witness to the difficulties of making the right call under any circumstances. Remember, too, that being open is not only a way to truth and understanding, but also helps build relationships. I learned a long time ago that in marriage, family life, friendship, there is no such thing as a contract. But we agreed does not work when feelings change. Empathy is a branch of openness, and empathy is crucial to any relationship at any level. Keep notes. Ask yourself, what have I learned? Why didn't I understand that? And how well did I follow my own principles? Everyone from researchers to wine experts knows that by writing down your impressions, you understand your experience better and have a reference point for the future. And finally, know that aging makes it all much easier. The older you grow, the less certain you are, and the more you appreciate what humans have done with curiosity. Age will help you out, making you more patient of yourselves and others and more willing to be open to the baffling but exhilarating mysteries of the world. So there are the 10 ideas. Know your bad impulses. Feel our vast ignorance. Work at seeing the complexity of things, not the answers. Make it a habit. Ask more questions than provide answers. Imagine you are the person you disagree with. See complexity in ordinary life. Be open and empathetic in relationships. Keep notes and let age help you out. I have been very fortunate to have my professional life correspond to my personal life. Freedom of speech, the great American university, and being a law professor and president of Columbia have all been interwoven. This has given me a mine of precious materials from which to draw, from the national to the quotidian. I love each, and I love them all together. I still do not understand all I need to, but as they intersect, I understand each better. I hope and expect you will find the same is true in your lives. Let me return to my opening remark that this is my last commencement address. The commencement speech is one of the hardest in life to give. No remarks can live up to the meaning that this has for all of you. It is a bit of a trap because when you try to close the gap, the risk is that you will end up with the cliche and the banal. Enough said on that. I only ask that you give me credit for being self-aware. But for sure, the commencement speech focuses the mind. And if you're ever asked to give one, I strongly urge you to say yes, and then get out of town as quickly as possible. My deepest congratulations to all of you, and especially my fellow graduates of 2023. Thank you.
Provost of the University, Mary C. Boyce, will present the candidates for the University Medal of Excellence and candidates for degrees in honoris causa. Please hold your applause until after all citations have been read.
Mr. President, I have the honor to present Katori Hall for the University Medal for Excellence.
I read the citation.
Yes. Do you need my book?
Katori Hall, you are a distinguished playwright, screenwriter, and TV creator. Your work offers a fresh, vital perspective into the lives of Black people in America, which you depict with nuance, empathy, and humor. After graduating from Columbia College and then Harvard and Juilliard, you debuted your first plays, Hoodoo Love and The Mountaintop. You went on to launch the Broadway hit, Tina, the Tina Turner musical. And the play, The Hot Wing King, which won a Pulitzer Prize for drama in 2021. Television followed with P-Valley, adapted from your play, and which won the NAACP Image Award for Outstanding Drama Series. For your groundbreaking work, Columbia is proud to present you with the University Medal of Excellence. Congratulations, Katori. I'm going to leave Mike.
Mr. President, I have the honor to present Jeannie Batchelor Levine and Jonathan Scott Levine as recipients of the degree of Doctor of Laws, honoris causa.
Jeannie Batchelor Levine, you have committed yourself for decades to the people and causes that need you the most. After earning degrees from Harvard, you and your husband, with your husband Jonathan, devoted yourself to critical issues, including access to education, advancements in healthcare, and understanding history. At Columbia, you have supported schools and programs including Columbia College, the Arts and Sciences, Columbia Barnard Hillel, and the Mailman School, and the Mailman School of Public Health. Your generosity has also funded critical initiatives focused on student life, faculty scholarship, and our neighbors. In all that you have accomplished, the common thread that runs throughout is the profound empathy and understanding that motivates your work. For your grace, your drive, and your heart, Columbia is proud to present you with the degree of Doctor of Laws, honoris causa. Jeannie. Jonathan Scott Levine. As a young person, you knew that you were meant to use your talents to create meaningful change. As a student at Columbia College, you traveled around New York City, studying issues like criminal justice, domestic violence, and urban politics. When you achieved great professional success, you focused on giving back to others. At Columbia, your generosity and that of your wife, Jeannie, have touched nearly every corner of the institution. The college, go ahead. neuroscience, climate, public health, the arts and sciences, Jewish life, financial aid, athletics. And the list goes on. You have also served in nearly every leadership role available to alumni, including as chair of the Board of Trustees. For your intelligence, your compassion, and your service, Columbia is proud to present you with the degree of Doctor of Laws honoris causa. Congratulations, Jonathan.
Mr. President, I have the honor to present Nemet Manush Shafiq for the degree of Doctor of Laws honoris causa.
Manush Shafiq, you are a talented economist, a dedicated public servant, and a celebrated global leader. You have spent your career making sense of the world to improve the lives of those within it. You have served at the highest levels of the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, the Bank of England, and the London School of Economics and Political Science. On July 1, 2023, you will become the 20th president of Columbia University. Your talents will help build on the efforts of those who have come before to create new knowledge, educate future leaders, and grapple with the greatest challenges facing our world. And as you take on this role, we and all members of the university community are behind you. For your empathy, your brilliance, and your achievements, Columbia is proud to present you, our next president, with the degree of Doctor of Laws honoris causa. Congratulations.
Mr. President, I have the honor to present Bob Woodward for the degree of Doctor of Laws honoris causa.
Nice first. Thank you very much.
Bob Woodward, your reporting on governmental power has changed. Has changed the course of our nation's history. Famously, you partnered with Carl Bernstein at the Washington Post for a story focused on the Watergate break-in and cover-up, which eventually led to the resignation of then-President Richard Nixon. Books on George Bush, Columbia College graduate Barack Obama, Donald Trump, and many others that followed. Through this work, you have helped generations of Americans better understand their government and demand accountability from their elected representatives. Your achievements have led to countless awards, including two Pulitzer Prizes and the Walter Cronkite Award for Excellence in Journalism. For a lifetime of transformative work, Columbia is proud to present you with the degree of Doctor of Laws honoris causa. Congratulations, Bob.
Mr. President, I have the honor to present Joyce A. Ladner as the recipient of the Doctor of Letters honoris causa.
Joyce Ladner, as a sociologist, author, activist, and educator, you have forever changed the conversation about gender, black women, and the lived experience of black people. You were active in the civil rights movement in college before completing your PhD. Your book, Tomorrow's Tomorrow, The Black Woman, changed the orthodoxy of the social sciences. This and your later works have become canonical texts in your field. At Howard University, you were known for being an extraordinary professor and a cherished mentor. For your efforts to create a better world for women, for marginalized communities, and for all of us, Columbia is proud to present you with the degree of Doctor of Letters honoris causa. Congratulations, Joyce.
Mr. President, I now have the honor to present Tanya Leon for the degree of Doctor of Music, honoris causa.
Composer, conductor, educated, pioneer, advocate for the arts, citizen of the world, Tanya Leon, your work has redefined the sound of being American. After leaving Cuba in 1967, you became a founding member and the first music director of Dance Theater of Harlem. You went on to compose famous orchestral works, including Stride, which won a Pulitzer Prize in Music. Soon, you will become the London Philharmonic Orchestra's composer in residence and concurrently hold the Richard and Barbara Debs Composer's Chair at Carnegie Hall. Your honors and awards include those from the Kennedy Center, the Guggenheim Foundation, and the National Endowment for the Arts. For your astounding body of work, Columbia is proud to present you with the degree of Doctor of Music, honoris causa. Congratulations.
Mr. President, I have the honor to present Xing Tong Yo for the degree of Doctor of Science, honoris causa, in absentia. His son, Isaac Chu, will accept on his behalf.
Xing Tong Yo, over the course of a brilliant career, you have proved the viability of essential scientific theories. Your work spans a wide array of disciplines, including differential geometry, general relativity, and string theory. Indeed, it is hard to find an area in the field of modern geometric analysis that does not bear your imprint. You have been called an ambassador of mathematics. Countless students have benefited from your wise and thoughtful mentorship. You have worked hard to promote mathematics and basic research in China, building relationships between academic institutions there and in the United States. For your talents, your generosity, and your scholarship, Columbia is proud to present you with the degree of Doctor of Science honoris causa. Please convey our congratulations to your father.
President of the university will present the awards for outstanding teaching. The professors will stand as their names are announced. Please hold your applause until all recipients have been recognized.
With deepest admiration, we recognize these professors selected by the campus community for this honor, for their sustained excellence in teaching, and for their remarkable dedication to the intellectual development of their students. Paul Ingram, Mike Miller Eismer, Michael Shapiro, and Nim Tatnam.
The university will present the Faculty Mentoring Awards. The professors will stand as their names are announced.
The Faculty Mentoring Awards celebrates senior faculty who have demonstrated outstanding characteristics of a mentor and spearheaded initiatives to increase the recruitment and development of diverse faculty. With deepest admiration, we recognize these professors, selected by their peers for this award, for their exceptional commitment to faculty mentorship and career development for tenure track and mid-career faculty. Henry Hess, Cliff Stein, Julian Teitler, and Mabel Wilson. Please stand.
President of the university will present the Faculty Service Awards. The professors will stand as their names are announced.
The Faculty Service Award recognizes full-time faculty whose extraordinary and creative voluntary service has contributed significantly to the university's diversity, equity, and inclusion efforts. With deepest admiration, we recognize these professors selected by their peers for this award. Madupe Akinola, Olatunde Johnson, William Turner, and Ovita Williams.
President of the university will present the 2023 alumni medalists. The alumni will stand as their names are announced.
The alumni medal is the highest award bestowed by the Columbia Alumni Association in recognition of distinguished service and commitment to the university. I am pleased to recognize the 2023 alumni medal recipients for their extraordinary dedication to Columbia. Please stand. Carlos Cruz, Vivian Lewis, Carol Lowenson, Diane McCoy, Joati Menon, Alexander Ned, Jean-Pierre Reichenbach, Lulu Chao Wong, Richard Witten, Annette Wu, Congratulations and thank you to all of them.
And now, a message of congratulations from former chair of the Columbia Alumni Association, Keith Goggin.
Good morning. My name is Keith Goggin, and I'm a 1991 graduate of the School of Journalism, a trustee of Columbia University, and as Amy just mentioned, former chair and current member of the Columbia Alumni Association. I'm here to congratulate you, the class of 2023, on your commencement. I've had a chance to meet many of you during your time as students, and those of you who know me have probably heard me say that while we want you all to graduate, you don't have to leave. As I look out into the sea of blue, it's clear to me that you can't all stay here. But what you can do is take Columbia with you around the globe by connecting with your fellow alumni wherever you go. Because today is not the end of your Columbia journey, it is the beginning of your life as a Columbia alum. You are now part of a powerful global community of bright, talented, and diverse Columbia graduates. Whether you stay at Columbia, stay in the New York area, move around the country, or move to another country, go forward with the knowledge that with over 100 international and domestic clubs and shared interest groups worldwide, wherever you go, Columbia is already there, waiting for you. Follow the CAA, your school, and your favorite clubs on email and social media to stay up to date. In short, take advantage of everything your status as a Columbia graduate confers. You have earned it. Congratulations again, class of 2023. Welcome to the Columbia alumni community. We can't wait to see what you do next.
So we've overlooked two people for awards, and I want them to stand. For outstanding teacher, Yi Zhang from engineering. And for faculty service, Frank Garidi from the history department. Congratulations.
Provost of the university will present the administrative officers of the various divisions of the university, who will in turn introduce candidates for the degrees in course in their respective groups. Those candidates will be expected to rise as they are being introduced.
And now we begin. Mr. President, it is my pleasure to present Yosef Thorat, Dean of Columbia College.
Mr. President, seated before you are the 1,259 graduates of the Columbia College Class of 2023. Who, with resilience and indomitable spirit, have completed all the requirements for the degree of Bachelor of Arts as prescribed by Columbia College and the faculty who teach therein. They have pursued their curiosity and intellectual passions, demonstrating the requisite subject knowledge in the arts, humanities, natural sciences, and social sciences, while also taking full advantage of the resources of our campus, New York City, and the world. They participated in a shared process of intellectual and social inquiry, brought their unique perspectives to bear on it as they absorbed the lessons of and also breathed new life into the core curriculum. This, their unique heritage as Columbia College students. Truly, they have both mastered the canon and critiqued the very idea of such mastery. They have acquired focused expertise in their selected majors and concentrations from across the arts and sciences, all too many to enumerate here, and all the while grappling with the perennial questions that shape our society. Accordingly, they arrive today well prepared for life as engaged citizens in our complex and rapidly changing world. And while I'm charged to speak for them, the graduates of Columbia College have shown repeatedly that their collective roar commands our attention. For the 21st time and final time in your tenure as president of Columbia University, I implore you, sir, indeed I beg that you grant them this degree, along with the rights and privileges thereto attached, to which they are rightfully entitled.
Mr. President, before you stands the amazing, resilient, creative, and endlessly inspiring candidates of the faculty of the Fu Foundation School of Engineering and Applied Science, the Columbia Engineering Class of 2023. The solutions of tomorrow will come from these more than 2,000 talented students who are waving their hammers before you today. They are racing electric cars, sending payload into space, engineering without borders, mastering robotics, laying the foundation of ethic AI, bridging technology and democracy, improving climate models with data science, advancing precision medicine, making our cities smarter, and making our world more inclusive and accessible. They are leaving the halls of Columbia for Lower Manhattan or higher education, for Silicon Valley and Silicon Alley, for the cloud and the blockchain, and over outer space. They will be the best ambassador for our Engineering for Humanity vision. They will be here, there, and everywhere all at once. Mr. President, all together, these students before you are deeper than ChatGPT, more powerful than fusion, and have more potential than quantum computing. Each of these candidates have completed the rigorous requirement for the degrees of the Bachelor of Science, Master of Science, Master of Philosophy, Doctor of Engineering Science, and Doctor of Philosophy, prescribed by the Faculty of Fu Foundation School of Engineering and Applied Science. They are engineers for humanity. I urge you, sir, to grant them this degree with all the responsibility, rights, and privilege attached. Seize the world, 2023.
President, it is my pleasure to present C.M. Bylock, President of Barnard College.
It is my honor and my pleasure to present to you the exceedingly brilliant, fiercely loyal, exceptionally compassionate, deeply empathetic, totally unshakable, unflinchingly persistent, and always resilient Barnard class of 2023. The students you see before you in the sea of Barnard blue have faced down every challenge thrown at them in the past 4 years and emerged stronger, united, and full of conviction. They have excelled in their fields of study, won scholarships and awards, conducted critical research, served as mentors to those around them, and created breathtaking art. They have already begun to change the world. As you and I are well aware, Mr. President, sometimes life will take us on new paths, even away from a place as magical as Barnard. In just a few minutes, the paths of these students will diverge from each other, but I can assure you they are prepared for whatever lies ahead. These students have completed the requirements prescribed by the faculty of Barnard College for the Bachelor of Arts degree. I beg you, sir, to grant them this degree along with the rights, responsibilities, and privileges thereto attached. Congratulations, Barnard class of 2023.
It is my pleasure, Mr. President, it is my pleasure to present Lisa Rosenmitch, Dean of the School of General Studies.
Thank you. Congratulations.
Mr. President, I am honored to present to you the highly accomplished candidates of the Columbia School of General Studies class of 2023. These candidates hail from over 64 countries. We are so proud that the class of 2023 is comprised of 108 veterans of the U.S. Armed Services, one of the largest cohorts ever to graduate at an Ivy League university since World War II. Holding their wise owls, our GSers are amazing. With backgrounds in ballet and now biology, going from the Navy to neuroscience, from the runway to religion, from the Marines to mathematics, and from Sciences Po to sociology, and from community college to the core curriculum. We have candidates from our amazing international dual degree programs and joint program with Liss College at JTS. We have parents and students who have excelled in the face of adversity, and many of these students are the first in their families to go to college. Our GS students follow the untraditional path. They complement life experience with intellectual abilities and make Columbia truly unique and the Columbia undergraduate classroom like no other. Mr. President, these candidates have completed the requirements as prescribed by their faculty in the arts and sciences for the degree of Bachelor of Arts. As the very proud first alumna dean of this exceptional school, please grant them this degree along with rights and privileges thereto attached. And thank you, President Bollinger, for 21 years of amazing leadership.
Mr. President, it is my pleasure to introduce Troy Eggers, Dean of the School of Professional Studies.
Hi, Troy. Dear Mr. President, I am deeply honored to present to you the candidates of Columbia School of Professional Studies, Class of 2023. These candidates are exemplary school and university citizens who have demonstrated academic and professional excellence. They are fierce and they will lead. They will carry forth transformative change in their fields, and they know, to quote you, sir, that you cannot assume that the world will get better and better. It requires constant effort to make the case. I can avow that they are up to the task. It is fitting that in your last commencement as president, you have the privilege of witnessing the school's best class yet. On their behalf and that of the entire school, please accept our deepest gratitude for all that you and your wife Jean have done for Columbia, for higher education, and indeed for the world. These candidates have completed the requirements as prescribed by the Faculty of Professional Studies for the degrees of Master of Science and Master of Professional Studies. Mr. President, please grant them these degrees, along with the rights and privileges thereto attached.
Mr. President, it is my pleasure to introduce Carol Becker, Dean of the School of the Arts.
Mr. President, because you and I have been doing this together for a long time, you already know that over there, on the extreme left, stand the wildly talented candidates of the faculty of the School of the Arts in film, theater, visual arts, sound arts, and writing. They have come to us from 30 countries and most states of the US. They are remarkably creative, savvy, hip, and profoundly engaged in the issues of the world. True, they can be irreverent, but at times they should be irreverent. Mostly they are original and resourceful, and they have survived some very difficult years, but nonetheless have won many awards, presented, screened, performed, produced, and published their work in esteemed venues around the world. And miraculously, while accomplishing all this, they have completed the requirements prescribed by the faculty for the degrees of Master of Arts and Master of Fine Arts. Mr. President, this group of artists is so very ready to take flight into the even more glamorous, challenging, and exciting worlds of global art, literary, film, theory, and scholarship that await them. So, Mr. President, has there ever been a time when art and culture and the hope they bring have been more needed than now? Has there ever been a time when human-based embodied creativity has been more essential to imagining a future for ourselves and for this planet than it is now? So, Mr. President, you really have to let them go. I promise you, they will take on the problems of the world in uniquely heartfelt and always dramatic ways. And Mr. President, as those artists and arts practitioners who have come before, this group also will make Columbia very proud.
Mr. President, it is my pleasure to present Karen Yarhimilo, Dean of the School of International and Public Affairs.
Mr. President, it is. It is my distinct honor to present the candidates of the Faculty of International and Public Affairs, Class of 2023. They have completed the requirements for the degree of Master of International Affairs and Master of Public Administration. Hailing from 70 countries, they embody the best of this truly global university. Columbia's fourth purpose is their first purpose. Mr. President, with your permission, I look forward to unleashing their talents onto the world so that they can fight the good fight with their tremendous energy, enthusiasm, and commitment to thinking locally to globally. These graduates have embraced CIPA's missions of translating innovative research and rigorous scholarship into practical solutions to the most daunting challenges. And boy, does the world need them. These graduates will be entering a world of growing uncertainty and complexity, but also tremendous opportunity. CIPA has instilled in them the values and given them the confidence to go out and make a difference, charging them with such tasks of defending democracy, protecting the rights of minorities and the marginalized, and advancing peace, security, and human welfare. Mr. President, before you are the heads of states, diplomats, global entrepreneurs, inventors, and thought leaders of tomorrow, who will shape the next chapter of human history. Their passion, determination, and brilliance will make Columbia proud. I therefore ask you, strike that, beg you, to grant them their degrees along with the rights and privileges thereto attached. Thank you, Mr. President.
President, it is my pleasure to present Melissa Begg, Dean of the School of Social Work.
Mr. President, it is my great honor to present to you that the furthest left, over there, the newest graduates of the oldest school of social work in the country. They are advocates, agitators, and activists working shoulder to shoulder with the most vulnerable among us. They have a vision for the future in which equity and human dignity are paramount, and they stand ready to make that vision a reality. I wish to honor this outstanding group of social workers, these champions of social justice and racial justice, borrowing words from a great songwriter. Though you always do for others, though your songs may be unsung, I know you'll build a ladder to the stars and climb on every rung. Mr. President, the candidates of the Faculty of Social Work have completed the requirements prescribed by that faculty for the degree of Master of Science. I beg you, sir, to grant them this degree, along with all the rights and privileges thereto attached.
Mr. President, it is my pleasure to present Christian Stoller, Dean of our College of Dental Medicine.
Mr. President, I present to you the Doctor of Dental Surgery and Master of Science candidate of the College of Dental Medicine. These candidates are unquestionably the most advanced of the more than 2,000 graduates that we presented to you in your tenure as Columbia's president. Our candidates received a biomedical foundation from the distinguished faculty of the Vagelos College of Physicians and Surgeons, side by side with the medical students, which sets them apart from the rest. With respect to their clinical skills, the faculty has certified their uncontested competence to handle the upper jaw, the lower jaw, to drill on teeth and bones, and cut gums, ligaments, tongue, and cheek. They can take care of infants, children, adolescents, adults, and the elderly, and those with medical problems and special needs. They can operate painlessly, and Mr. President, just between you and me, they also know what causes pain and hopefully remember so. Mr. President, the faculty tells me that our candidates have become restless and need to be released into the wild. In agreement with the recommendation of the distinguished faculty of the College of Dental Medicine, I request, or should I go on my knees, Mr. President, to confer upon these candidates the degrees Doctor of Dental Surgery and Master of Science in recognition of their completion of all requirements.
Mr. President, it is my pleasure to present Costis Maglaris, Dean of the Columbia Business School.
Congratulations, Costis.
Mr. President, the candidates of the Faculty of Business have completed the ridiculously complex requirements prescribed by that faculty for the degrees of Masters of Business Administration and Master of Science. These daring and entrepreneurial candidates decided to quit whatever they were doing in the middle of the pandemic and arrived at our school from all corners of the world. They stared down disruption and uncertainty, and in the face of it, they took on some risk, levered up, and came to the school prepared for change and to have impact. They have innovated, they have engaged, they have excelled. They pushed us to do more, they helped us to be better, they connected to the ideas of the local communities and then with each other. They were quite impatient with our post-pandemic restart, with events, with galas, with celebrations, with conferences, and with a few parties along the way. More than 100. More than 100 founded or co-founded startup ventures in these 2 years to make the world safer, greener, and more efficient. We taught you useful tools, you made them meaningful. And mostly, for us, they were trailblazers. They were our trailblazers, and they took us from this wonderful campus in Morningside into our new home in Manhattanville, launching us into an ambitious new chapter of our school, a move that capped a long effort, addressed a pressing need, and without a doubt will fill the future with promise and positive impact. A move that is a result of your own vision, Mr. President, for the future of this university, and your determination to execute on it. Thank you, Lee. These candidates are agile, they're curious, they're determined, innovative, ethical, and socially responsible as they launch into the next journeys. They will tackle new challenges and find new solutions. They will introduce ideas, businesses. They may even invent entire new industries along their ways. They will innovate, disrupt, and challenge the status quo. They will change business, and they will save society, and without a doubt, they will change our world, much like we have seen them, how they changed us. With sincerity, with admiration, and with great, great expectations for the future, congratulations, Columbia Business School of 2023 class. Mr. President, please grant them these degrees along with the rights hitherto attached and the privilege thereto attached.
Mr. President, it is my pleasure to present Jelani Cobb, Dean of our Graduate School of Journalism.
Mr. President, I am happy to present to you the brilliant, accurate, ethical, timely, and courageous candidates of the 2023 class of Columbia Journalism School. Now, Mr. President, we live in complicated times. We are beset by large, pressing questions regarding our economy, our foreign policy, social inequality, climate change, and artificial intelligence. Most crucially, we must find a way to understand why the New York Knicks did not perform better in the playoffs. We need answers. We need information. It is our great fortune to have a repository of information on these crucial issues called journalism. We are in the business of finding, verifying, and disseminating the information people need to make informed decisions about their lives. No, we cannot fix the New York Knicks, but our work appears in the nick of time. At our best, we are a bulwark for our democracy. And it is in service to this cause that we can offer more than 200 dedicated, talented, and ethical reinforcements from the Graduate School of Journalism, the class of 2023. They have spent an intense year learning audio reporting, investigative techniques, data journalism, documentary filmmaking, and journalism ethics, along with the highest standards of accuracy in reporting. Mr. President, I humbly request, indeed I beseech you, to grant these candidates the master's and doctoral degrees they have earned, along with the rights and privileges thereto attached.
Mr. President, it is my pleasure to present Andres Hocke, the Dean of our Graduate School of Architecture, Planning, and Preservation.
Mr. President, to your left stand the 447 candidates of the School of Architecture, Planning, and Preservation. They are creative, engaged, they're exceptional. They are the ones wearing yellow glasses, as I do. They are wearing these sunglasses because they're ready to go. Some of them have even brought their luggage with them, and their kids, and dogs. Mr. President, this is unbelievable. They are amazing people. They are able to mix math with proteins as a construction material to empower communities to build their own schools and homes. They are already advising They are already advising the cities of Cali, Cartagena, and Bogota on how to repair their ecosystems. They have drawn guidelines for inclusivity in the housing of cities with financial analysis and policy planning. At this moment, they are too smart. There is no way we can contain them, Mr. President. And they have made friends all around the world that who are also pushing for them to impact the world and go out there. Mr. President, I beg you, sir, to alleviate this huge pressure. Please grant the students these degrees along with the rights and privileges thereto attached.
Mr. President, it is my pleasure to present Thomas Bailey, President of Teachers College.
Mr. President, I ask that you grant the degrees of Master of Arts, Master of Education, Master of Science, Doctor of Education, and Doctor of Philosophy to our highly motivated and incredibly diverse Teachers College candidates who have risen to levels of achievement that are beyond our imagination. Yes, we are Teachers College, the oldest, largest, in our opinion, the best school of education in the country. But our graduates are not just teachers and educators, they're also artists, health professionals, psychologists, and researchers. These graduates are bright and driven, are committed to promoting social justice, equity, diversity, and inclusion. Our graduates have actively contributed to to bringing innovative solutions to the most prevalent issues of our time, including poverty, mental health, climate change, racial justice, and more. From the COVID-19 pandemic to attending Zoom classes and adapting to new normals, our graduates have gone through it all, Mr. President. They are still standing. I am confident in the ability of our graduates as leaders in the fields of health, psychology, and education to continue to touch lives of others, to ignite courage, and lead change to build a better tomorrow. President Bollinger, I request that you grant their degrees along with the rights and privileges attached therein, and I want to thank TC 2023 grad Liana Villanueva for writing this wonderful statement for me to share with you today. Congratulations.
Mr. President, it is my pleasure to present Alexander Halliday, Maureen Ramo, and Jason Bordoff, deans of the Columbia Climate School.
Mr. President, before you stand a legion of climate warriors, the trailblazing graduates of the Columbia Climate School, all 78 of them, poised to receive their hard-earned master's degrees. These exceptional individuals have emerged from the crucible of academia, galvanized by the most formidable challenge humanity has ever faced, the climate crisis. Our scholars hailing from 17 countries are eager to wield their interdisciplinary training in the natural and social sciences to confront fearlessly the existential threat of climate change. Their abilities span the gamut, from pinpointing climate risks and vulnerabilities, strategizing with diverse stakeholders, forging evidence-based and equitable solutions, and communicating the gravity of our planetary predicament with unmatched passion and clarity. Furthermore, they are tirelessly in pursuit of accountability and driven by their unwavering commitment to the global urgency for just, workable transitions in energy, food, land use, cities and transportation. The magnitude of the climate challenge before us demands a seismic societal shift, and these graduates are ready to lead that charge. Mr. President, under your visionary guidance, Columbia University took the bold step of establishing the nation's first climate school to nurture the leaders our world so desperately needs. It is the oldest climate school in America, stretching back over 2 years of incredible history. On behalf of the climate school and my co-founding deans, we beseech you without a moment's hesitation to bestow upon these graduates their well-deserved degrees, along with the rights and privileges accompanying them. They are the vanguard of our future climate leaders, and the world awaits their expertise, and dedication.
Mr. President, it is my pleasure to now introduce Jillian Lester, Dean of the Columbia Law School.
Mr. President, 51 years, 11 months, and 16 days ago, the law school dean, Michael Sovereign, stood at this podium and implored President William McGill to award degrees in law to the graduating class of 1971. Among that distinguished cohort was a graduate who would go on to shape the course of the First Amendment, change the face of American higher education, and to leave an indelible mark on the future of this great university, a graduate named Lee C. Bollinger. Today, Mr. President, as we mark the conclusion of your transformational leadership over the course of more than two decades, I ask you one last time to grant degrees to an astonishing group of candidates who follow in your footsteps as graduates of Columbia Law School. To my left are the candidates presented to you. Are the candidates presented to you by the Faculty of Law, having completed the requirements prescribed by that faculty for the degrees of Juris Doctor, Master of Laws, and Doctor of the Science of Law. Their spirits abound with purpose and principle. They are empathic advocates, guardians of justice, and champions of the underserved. They are brilliant, they are brave, and they even know some Latin. Today, in the presence of their loved ones and under the watchful eye of alma mater, they officially inherit the legacy of generations of Columbia lawyers as leaders, change makers, institution builders, and defenders of democracy, and the world really, really needs them. So I beg of you, Mr. President, that you grant them these degrees, along with the rights and privileges thereto attached.
Mr. President, it is my pleasure to present Katrina Armstrong, Executive Vice President for Health and Biomedical Sciences, Dean of the Faculties of Health Sciences and the Vagelos College of Physicians and Surgeons.
Mr. President, on this glorious day, a day to celebrate Columbia and to celebrate you, sir, I have the incredible honor of presenting to you the remarkable class, the candidates of the Faculty of Medicine class of 2023. These extraordinary individuals standing before you are brilliant and caring, fearless and determined, curious and disciplined, heroic and selfless. They have educated their exceptional minds and strengthened their stout hearts. Now they go forward to assume the unique and awe-inspiring responsibility of being the person that we turn to at our times of greatest need. Ahead of them is a lifetime dedicated to improving human health, curing disease, preventing illness, and alleviating suffering. Mr. President,
It is a quest, I would argue, at a level of consequence and complexity above all others. These students of the Vagelos College of Physicians and Surgeons have met the truly exacting requirements of the faculty for the degrees of Doctor of Medicine, Doctor of Occupational Therapy, Doctor of Physical Therapy, Master of Science in Human Nutrition, and Master of Science in Genetic Counseling. They have overcome imposing challenges, shown great fortitude, and made us so very, very proud. Their dream of a just and equitable society, one that recognizes access to high-quality healthcare as a fundamental right, their dream is within their grasp, and I know they will see that dream realized. And so, Mr. President, on this incredible day, inspired by the brighter future that these candidates offer and the future that you have created for us, I beseech you, sir, to please, please grant them their degrees, which they richly deserve, along with the rights and privileges attached.
Mr. President, it is my pleasure to present Lorraine Frazier, Dean of our School of Nursing.
Mr. President, the candidates for the Faculty of Nursing have completed the requirements prescribed by that faculty for the degrees of Master's of Science, Doctorate of Nursing Practice, and Doctorate of Philosophy. They are the newest Columbia-educated members of the country's most trusted profession. For the past 22 years, nurses have been rated America's most ethical and honest professionals. These graduates will now join those ranks in caring for the nation, the health of the nation, as expert practitioners, superb scholars, excellent educators, and thoughtful policymakers, as well as constantly advancing the state of healthcare with their scientific mindset, innovative spirit, resilience, and sense of commitment and compassion. Nurses are trailblazers. They foster a social justice and health equity. We pioneer solutions that heal individuals, communities, and populations. Our nation needs more nurses. And I am so proud to usher our 2023 graduates into the world where they will continue to serve and advance the health for all. Mr. President, I beg you to please grant them their degrees along with the rights and privileges thereto attached.
Mr. President, it is my pleasure to present Linda Freed, Dean of the Mailman School of Public Health.
Thank you, Linda. Thank you, 100 years.
Mr. President, it is my honor to present
the centennial class of 2023 of Columbia University's Mailman School of Public Health, one of the three original schools of public health in the United States. And as you can hear, Mr. President, before you stand the world's future leaders for the public's health, socially committed, relentlessly global, locally grounded, politically astute, pandemically capable, with the knowledge to create the healthy populations resilient to the threats of our future that create the essential foundation of successful societies. These students, soon to be graduates, are diverse, they're kind, and they are stupendously brilliant candidates from the Mailman School of Public Health. Sir, these candidates have lived the first, the second, the third, and the fourth purposes of the university. And they are prepared now to launch the second century of public health. These candidates hail from countries across the globe. We need them. They should not be detained from their noble mission of improving health and preventing disease throughout the world. They are the foundation of our future. And I am proud to say that they have completed the requirements prescribed by their faculty for the degrees of Master of Health Administration, Master of Public Health, Master of Science, and Doctor of Public Health. So, sir, I deeply beseech you to grant them these degrees along with the rights and responsibilities thereof.
Mr. President, it is my pleasure to present Carlos Alonso, Dean of our Graduate School of Arts and Science.
Hi, Carlos. Really, thank you so much. It's been wonderful serving with you.
Mr. President, before you stand the candidates of the faculty of the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences who have completed the requirements prescribed by that faculty for the degrees of Master of Arts, Master of Philosophy, Doctor of Musical Arts, and Doctor of Philosophy, the highest degree in the land. Some of them have been toiling for many years to reach this day on which they will bestow the highest degree offered by this world-renowned house of learning over which you have presided for many years. Many of these candidates have achieved the Master of Arts degree. But Master of which arts, Mr. President? The art of procrastination has many sub-disciplines, such as the art of the snack break, the art of binge-watching Love is Blind, and the art of guessing today's Wordle in two tries. So many arts, so little time. Yet they have persisted in their studies, and I feel confident in recommending to you that they be granted their degrees. To my great chagrin, I have heard these PhD candidates referred to as know-it-alls, even by their own professors and their loved ones. But to me, They are simply scholars shouldering the burden of being the smartest person in the room. Whatever the room, just don't put two of them together in the same room, because I cannot be responsible for the consequences. But not content with their original contributions to the analysis of, say, politics of naturalism in global cinema, or the study of ultra-high resolution spectral domain optical coherence, they have taken to social media to apply their Columbia-given analytical skills to seek answers to the existential questions of our time. Namely, why can't Ted Lasso just date Rebecca? Why is pickleball called pickleball? How could Taylor Swift break up with Joe after 6 years? Wasn't Joe her muse? And if ChatGPT is so smart, can it please explain Kendall Jenner and Bad Bunny? And glory be, after today, these doctoral candidates will never hear again from their relatives the invidious comparison that was made at least once at every family gathering that your cousin Ricky's a real doctor and he finished in 4 years. But above all, we want all the candidates to know that we are so very proud of them for their perseverance, for their hard work, and for the transcendent research they have produced in the end. Hence, I beseech you, sir, to grant them these degrees along with the rights and privileges thereto attached.
Will all candidates for degrees in course rise for the conferring of degrees by the president?
Okay, the appropriate academic authorities have determined and have so reported to me. Those students who have satisfactorily completed the course of study prescribed by the faculty under which they have each been enrolled as a candidate for a university degree. In accordance with the authority vested in me as president of the university, I now admit each of you to the degree for which you have qualified. In token whereof, you will subsequently receive your diploma. Congratulations to all of you.
Now rise and join the Columbia Student String Ensemble, the Crown Quartet, in a special performance of Stand Columbia.
Thank you.
please remain standing and join the Columbia Student a cappella group, Notes and Keys, in the singing of New York State of Mind.
Some folks like to get away, take a holiday from the neighborhood. Hop a flight to Miami Beach or to Hollywood. But I'm taking a Greyhound on the Hudson River line. I'm in a New York State of Mind. I've seen all the movie stars in their fancy cars and their limousines. Been high in the Rockies under the evergreens. But I know what I'm needing and I don't want to waste more time. I'm in the New York State. So easy living day by day, out of touch with the rhythm and blues. But now I need a little give and take. The New York Times, the Daily News, it comes down to reality. And it's fine with me, cause I let it slide. I don't care if it's Chinatown or on Riverside. I don't have any reasons, I left them all behind. I'm in a New York state of mind. I'm in a New York.
Remain standing for closing words by University Chaplain Janelle Davis.
Graduates, return to Columbia often to refresh your learning and to renew your spirit. Godspeed.
Guests, until the academic procession has returned to Loeb Memorial Library, guests of the university and the graduates are requested to remain in their places. Thank you for coming.